Here we are, post 9/11 Sunday. What did it feel like in the room that day?
It was remarkable, and it was an experience shared by many clergy with whom I've talked. I remember vividly standing on the steps of Duke Chapel about 20 of 11. The place was already packed. The president of the university, Nan Cohan, and her husband coming up, and she was there, and she wasn't normally there. So I was, and she said, "We have driven all night to be here, looking forward to your sermon." Such moments, I think, drive us back to better theology, Christology, than is often operative in our churches on a pleasant Sunday morning. And any time of crisis in one's personal life, in the national life and all, I think is a call for preaching. It's a call for theology. It's a call to say, okay, let's all get together now, shut the doors, everybody settle down. Okay, now we're going to think together like Christians about this.
You use this great phrase in the sermon. You say you were thrashing about for text, and you come upon Genesis 1, which is not only the first word God speaks in the Bible, but it's the first text you preach from in the chapel. And I want you to just speak to the theological and pastoral significance of that choice of text on that day.
Normally, I preach from the lectionary, so I don't thrash about looking for text in that way. But this day seemed to be different. And it seemed to be, I'm making a judgment that Genesis was written perhaps during a time of chaos in Israel, and a time to say, hey, in the beginning, God. And we don't know what the future holds. We don't know how this is all going to work out. We don't know what's coming next. We've been shaken. But we do know this world is God's. It's not ours to run. It's not ours to establish and protect and keep up. As I'm interpreting Genesis 1 and 2 and all, it's like God pushes back the chaos. God does not defeat the chaos utterly. And at any moment, the tohu wabohu can bubble back up, the formless void. And I love that phrase, the kind of formless void. Well, such times as 9/11 for many of us were a time when there wasn't a form, and the images of those huge architectural forms just collapsing. We build these cities, we build these structures, we build these philosophies, but it's just kind of a little crust. And at any moment, boom, the tohu wabohu bubbles up and threatens to overwhelm. And what do we do at such moments? Well, the church gets together and remembers and affirms, and so we kind of clench our fist and say, I believe God in the beginning, God, in the end, God.
There's this one point in a sermon where you talk about how difficult it's been for you to understand them, meaning these people that did this act. And I wondered in the sermon, how did you grapple with the fear of the other that was present in yourself and the congregation?
I think in thinking about the perpetrators of 9/11, I thought about, wow, they're actually people that plan to give their lives to this cause. They do this knowing that they will destroy thousands of innocent people. Wow, that's what does that mean for my humanity, our humanity? I know what a big deal this was for me to come up with a sermon on that Sunday, and so I thought, all right, fellow campus ministers around the country, and say, hey, what'd you preach Sunday after Tuesday? That became the title of the book, Sunday After Tuesday. I remember one of the sermons said a phrase that stuck in my mind. This is a dangerous time. The most powerful, unrestrained nation in the world is a victim. And the pastor said, I've been around a lot of victims in my ministry, and victimization can bring out the worst in us. And a chill went down my spine. You know, there was a spike in church attendance after 9/11, lasted about 3 months, about a 12% spike in attendance nationwide, and then it went back to where it was before 9/11. And people said, well, it's just a testimony to how fearful people felt and uncertain at that time before we could get up and get back going again. I said, and I said this in a sermon later, I think it was because people who hadn't been to church a long time came to church for comfort and compassion and help and healing. Jesus does that occasionally, but they came to church demanding that, and what they got was a living Lord. They got Jesus, who says, forgive your enemies, pray for those who persecute you, or feel somebody else's pain other than your own. At our service after 9/11, I not only preached, but we had a prayer of confession. We're all hurting, we're in pain, we're in fear. And the first thing the church does is say, all right, everybody stand and repeat after me. I am sinful, I've done wrong, God forgive me. That did not happen at the National Cathedral in the National Service. That was not said by Billy Graham or anybody else there. That's weird. Isn't it wonderful being a Christian? We can actually say, I'm not sure how I'm implicated in this, but God forgive me.
One of my favorite points in the sermon was you were talking about the risk of writing down, let there be light in a time of exile. And that there is a risk of what you call pushy, defiant poetry in the face of fear. I love that. And I wanted to ask you, what is the risk to the preacher of proclaiming the creative power of God when there's fear in the room? What do you risk?
It's risky when you're talking to hurting, fearful people to stand up and say, nevertheless, I believe God. Because many times people don't want to hear that. I want to say, that's a time when we must say that. When we don't believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, that's a time to all the more church make you affirm that. And I remember Brueggemann said that some of Israel's most passionate, sweeping poetry, like in Isaiah, was written at the lowest time for Israel. It was written in exile. Dare we offer a promise? Dare we say, this is not the end. God, it ain't the end till God says it's the end. God is the creator of the world. We can't destroy the world. That's God's business. I do think that's a word that's needed. I remember being in a church a while back, and we walk in, I think it was after the Orlando shootings, and the pastor says, we're here to lament. We're here to weep. We're here to light a fragile candle against the darkness. We're here to be with and to be in pain with the victims and all. And I said, well, hey, how about a little more here? Could we get defiant? Could the revolution start here? Could we condemn the NRA to hell? I mean, we got some stuff we could do besides. And I do think Christians, it's kind of scandalous to be hopeful in a hopeless time. Cornel West has kind of come in and said, I'm sorry, I'm a Christian. I'm not permitted to be that bleak and despairing. I got to keep hoping.
One final question. So you write this book, The Sunday After Tuesday. You see these sermons preached all over the country. Were there certain insights that you had after that, looking at what was preached in our nation at this time?
Three Sundays after 9/11, Ken Carter, Bishop Ken Carter, he was my guest preacher, and he took his text, it was a lectionary text from Jeremiah. And Ken basically retold this, and he said, the prophet Jeremiah says to suffering Israel in exile, you want to know why you're in exile? You want to know why your cities have been destroyed? You want to know why the towers have fallen? It's because of me. I sent the Assyrians. I sent them to teach. Well, the congregation just gasped. And then Ken said, what sort of God would have said things like this to hurting, suffering people? Have any of you heard any sermons the past couple of weeks saying this to us, that the possibility that God sent Egyptians to chastise us? I haven't, and I wouldn't preach that sermon, but Jeremiah does. He said, what kind of God would have said that to people? And then he said, just beautifully, he says, and what kind of people would have dared to be in conversation with this God?